professional, like work translation workflow oriented to enterprise. So Lingotek has been involved in Drupal for quite some time. There are a lot of downloads. We've been sponsoring a lot of Drupal events. We had Drupal support since Drupal 6. We're providing monthly releases of the Drupal 7 modules and hope to do that in Drupal 8 soon. And we are compatible with the most popular distributions out there. So, in terms of Drupal 7, how many people have built multilingual sites with Drupal 7? Can you raise hands? Yeah. So you probably face some issues with things that are not translatable in core. The English has been the only two-source language. So if you're building a monolingual site in a different language, you have to keep having English on your side. And for enhancing Drupal core support, you need like a lot of modules. And you have like a lot of possibilities, like different alternatives for doing the same thing. And sometimes you want to use one alternative for one content type and another one for another content type. And if you are building a, if you are using Drupal Commerce, you need the entity translation. So you usually end with a quite mess. There are different solutions, like for taxonomies, you can use the IATN module, or you can use the entity translation module. You usually have difficulties choosing which option to use. And in some cases, you want features from one option and from the other one, so you have to like prioritize them and do miss something on these choices. And with menus are the same. You want maybe to translate the menus or localize the menu for a given market, or you want to translate your menu items. So you have like a lot of different options. And one of our favorites is the field collection problem, because it's really fun to set up, but it has a lot of problems when trying to translate, and everything is really fragile, so it's difficult to get it right. So one of the things that the Lingotek module does, aside of providing translations, is that it tries to make easier to configure a Drupal 7 multilingual site, providing like sensible defaults, like so it's in 2-3 clicks you can enable your language switcher plug, and you can configure the different content types you have, and it's really easy to work with. But in Drupal 8, everything changed for better, we hope. And this has been a huge effort of a lot of people. If you've been in Gabor session this morning, you've seen how the team was organized and how we did this effort. And what I'm intending to show you is what we really did there. The multilingual support in Drupal 8 is based on 4 pillars. The language, and this translates to 4 different modules, not like we had before, 10 of them. So we have the language module, which provides the ability to assign languages to your data. Not just multilingual, but also monolingual. If you're building an Hungarian site, you can assign the Hungarian language to your content. The second pillar is the interface translation, with really improved usability and easier to update from your own translation files, or even from The community translations. The third one is the content translation module. If you remember from Drupal 7, you had two separate translation systems. So one was based on copying the node, and you had like several nodes for the same content, and the field-based translation, content translation, the TD translation model, and this in Drupal 8 we only have one option, which is based on the field translation, and it's quite flexible. And it's built for all kind of entities. And we also have the fourth pillar, it's the config translation model. As you may know, the config management is one of the most desired features in Drupal 8. And that's why the other room is probably packed. And the config translation module enables you to translate this config in for your different languages. So you can translate views and everything else. So we are going deeper in the first one, the language module. So the first thing you will notice when you install Drupal 8 is that the first step on the installer is choosing your language. And it detects your language from your browser. So you will see, like, from the first step, the big focus that has been on making Drupal 8 a nice multilingual solution. So the second thing is that you can assign language to almost every content, like notes, user, aliases, like in Drupal 7, but also to terms, views, your site information, everything will know in which language it is. Like in Drupal 7, there were a lot of assumptions, and so when you select your default language, and if you want to change it, you are probably messing everything. And this is easier now in Drupal 8. But even if your content or your configuration has a language assignment, the language selector is not always exposed. So sometimes you won't see it. Second thing is the language setup. So the UI changed a lot. So now you can check your different entities and assign how do you want them to behave by default. So you can choose the default language and select if you want to show the language selector or not on the page creation. And also there's a improved support for visibility. Like you can configure blocks based on the language of each page. You can integrate with views, so you can filter on the language of the content. And like everything in the Drupal administration now, it's views. You can really like customize your admin pages or any view. Yes, editing them, and you can like make a really language-aware administration page. So another improvement is the language selection. This means how when you hit Drupal with your browser, how it's negotiation about which language your content should be provided to the browser. So now you have like a single page where you can configure all the negotiation methods. And also you can like, we will see this later, but you can also check, configure different negotiation methods for the language interface of the UI and the content you are going to show. So it's quite flexible. And a new thing also is that, well, I think this, you can configure the administration pages. So maybe you have a foreign site, like for the Hungarian market, but maybe I don't know Hungarian. So I can configure that when I'm on an admin page, I can have it in English. And another thing is that you can enable, you can create mappings for different languages, like the browser language code. There are some cases like you don't have the same code in the languages on Drupal, so you can configure mappings from that. Another improvement is transliteration. So if you use like for creating paths, machine names or whatever, you can create them in your own language, and the machine names will be like ASCII code based. So you don't have to edit them by hand. And another improvement is that English can be deleted. So if you are building a monolingual site for a complete market, you can remove English from your site, and nothing will appear on English if you have the proper translation. So summarizing, we can delete English language. We have a flexible selection of how languages are negotiated with the browser. We have improvements in block visibility, like everything is in views, you can really configure your admin pages or anything and filter by language or whatever you want. Configuration is more flexible than in Drupal 7. There's a wider assignment of languages to your content or your data, and it's the first thing in the installer. So second pillar is interface translation, which has improved a lot too. So first thing is that translations download some updates from localizedrupal.org, is automated. So when you enable a language, this translation will be automatically downloaded, and when you install your site, they will be automatically downloaded too. You can also have a centralized translation file location. So if you want to manage your translation files using JIT, you can just put your translations in a folder and commit it like anything else on your site, and you can update from this folder. A really nice improvement is the customization tracking. So when you probably want to use the community provided translations, but in some cases you want to change some of them, but this blocks you from updating again, so you could override them. In Drupal 8, what we have is that you can mark them as customized, and in that case, you are protecting them for overwrites. And another improvement is that if you have like slow hosting, there were some issues in Drupal 7 with timeouts. Now the translation import is going in batches, so its files are broken down, so they are easier to import and they won't have timeouts. So there's a whole new improved user interface for the translations. So you can filter for the translation language. You can filter for the customized strings. or if they are translated already or not. And you will see like there is improvements in how singular and plural forms are handled. And like if you are editing several translations, they will be highlighted. So if you go for a coffee and come back, you will know that you still have pending chance to save, which is a good thing. And yeah, you can filter by different parameters. So another improvement is when you have an English site, there, how many times do you have to customize some scripts? So for Drupal 7, you had the string overwrite module, or you could do your string overwrites on settings PHP, but then you need like file access for modifying them. So one of the things that we did is that you can translate to English itself. This is something that is disabled by default because of performance. But now you can go to the English language and edit it. And you will find a checkbox, enable interface translation. And this way you can just change any string. Like if you want to change the login text for signing, you can just edit it on the user interface. So, in terms of interface translation, summarizing, we have the ability to translate to English. We have a whole improved user interface, which is quite easier to use. Your custom translations are tracked, so they are not overridden. When you update from your translations from anywhere else, you can have them in. You will have them in one folder, which you can manage with Git. If you want to, maybe you don't want to update your production translations directly, so you can do it in staging, test them. If you like them, commit them and import them in production from this folder. The translations will be auto-downloaded from localizedrupal.org. And it's a separate module from language. So now you the ability of assigning a language to your data is now separated from the interface translation. So the third pillar is content translation. As I said before, it's based on field translation. And you have a built-in API for all entities, so if you have any kind of entity, you will have the possibility to enable content translation, and it's easy to support it, and it provides a user interface. So the first great thing is that all content entities are supported, so any content module that is providing content entities can enable translation support really easily. But which are content entities? In Drupal 8, we have the concept of an entity, which is any kind of structured data that you want to save. Content entities are those that are created regularly, like nodes, users, comments, terms, contact message. So one thing of looking at it is a content entity is anything that can have a field assigned. So configuration of content translation is really easy. So you can configure it when you create them, but you also have a page where you can just configure everything in the same page. So this is the same configuration page we seen before, but with the content translation module, you have a translatable checkbox. And when you click it, you can see all the fields. You can check them. And you can also configure them at the subfield level, which is really useful. And the same for blocks or any kind of entity you have. So translation interface, it's unified for everything. Like you will have a translation tab where we can see, you can see if this content is translated to each of your languages. And another improvement is that in Drupal 7, you always had like a source language for all your translations. So if you translate from English to French, the French node or the French you will have in the French content like a memory that it was translated from the English one, and if you translate from French to Chinese, the Chinese translation will remember that it's from the English one, not the French one. So this is something that in Drupal 8 is different. So you can really save which translation, what source you were using for the translation. So if you edit the source, you will know that the translation is saved and maybe it needs update. And you can, if you go to the translation page and you have a field that is not translatable, but you have the permissions for editing all languages translations, you then will see these fields and you can edit from the same interface. But you will have a marker that you know that you are translating all the different translations for the same content. So upgrade path, well, you may know that there is no upgrade path from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, but now there's a migrating core. There is some work going on migrating from Drupal 6 and Drupal 7 to Drupal 8. Drupal 6 is almost covered, and there is a lot of work going on Drupal 7, but they are not taking multilingual sites into account now, and there is some work on that, but it's not in an advanced step yet, but at some point it will be there. So as search API, the core search and the core search API improve a lot, and it has language support for all your entities. And it's the same with the node access API. So you can configure, you can give granular permissions to different language translation of your content to different roles. And that's a big step in improving, like providing workflow, translation workflows in country. So summarizing, the node access API support, the search index are separate by languages, so they are easy to configure. Search APIs got update and have language support. Content translation module applies to all content entities. You can configure your translations per bundle, per field, and per subfield. And yeah, there's a migration path in the works. So config translation is the fourth pillar, and it provides the ability to configure, to translate your custom blocks, your views, field settings, your field labels, whatever. And it follows a similar approach than content translations in terms of the UI. So as we've seen before, we have content entities, which is anything, a structured data that you can add fields to. And there are, then we have configuration. We have like two types of configuration. One of them are based on entities, So they are called config objects. And then you can like have so like views, vocabularies, contact categories or fields. And then you can have other configuration which are not entities. And there are also other stuff like are other content that is not an entity, like path aliases. So if you are developing a country module and you are using content entities and configuration entities, providing language support and translation support would be really easy. But if you are using your own things by whatever reason, you have to build the language support by yourself. So every time you have the option to go with entities, you should probably do it. One of the things that the config files are safe on, by default, they are safe on YAML files, which are import. And they have a language property, so every config file knows which language is in. Language overrides are stored in the same way, than the rest of the config files. They are saved in your config folder. You will have a different folder for each language, and you will have the overrides there and saved in the same format. And for ship configuration, you will have already the translations from localized Drupal.org. Like if you have your contact forms and you go to Hungarian, you don't have the translation enabled, you can just look at the user interface module and look for your strings. And you can just translate it there, and it will be saved like a configuration file, but it's transparent to the user. So when you go back to Hungarian, you already have the Hungarian content there. So the localized Drupal.org integration is in the works, but it already has quite good support for config files. And it works for any kind of configuration, so you can translate any kind of log. So you can translate your blog titles, or if you have custom blogs with several fields, you can translate your fields there. So summarizing, config translation is a full translation solution for config files. It has the standard translation tags, so for end users or for site builders, it will be really they will be really familiar with it. You have the ability of providing config overrides, and they are saved with the config as anything as the config itself. It works for any config. If you use the right APIs or config entities, and ship config will be translated. So when you install in a non-English language, you will have your config translation too. So summarizing, these are the four pillars on Drupal 8: language, interface, content, and config. And as we've seen, there's a big difference in Drupal 7 with Drupal 8. It's really easy. So the Lingotek module is building on top of that. So for Drupal 7, it has a lot of hacks for supporting any choice that you do for the different translation methods you have. But for Drupal 8, it's been quite easy to build a module, because there is a lot of consistency about how it works, so APIs are really consistent. So I think it's going to be a cleaner solution. next thing I want to show is a bit about how the Drupal 8 module works. So I have some, I'm not doing a real demo, we have some screenshots here. So you will have your content, and as with Drupal core itself, you will have the translate tab. And when you go there, you have different options for each language. So on your original language, on your original content, you will have a Google upload button which submits your content to Lingotek servers. And then when the translation happens, if it's automatic translation, it's almost immediate. Or if you have your own translators, or if you are using the professional services, it can take a bit more, but when you have your translation, you will be notified. Your site will be notified and you can download them. And you will have the translation automatically published on your site. We provide a dashboard for your languages, so you can add languages quite fast. And like if you need to, first time you configure your site, you can add different languages in a row. And you can see the status of the translations for each language. In terms of configuration, it's more flexible than the Drupal 7 version because of the improved support in Drupal 8 core. Like you will have the ability to select your fields for which you want to submit for translation or not, and also at the subfield level, so you can send your image titles for translation, but you don't have to send the files itself. Another thing we provide is several profiles, different profiles, so you can create your own profiles in terms of if you want to upload your content automatically for translation or not, if you want to use automatic translation for one content type or one entity type or not, or professional services, or if you want to download your translation automatically and publish them, or you have different workflows for each kind. The current status is that we are supporting content content entities already. We are working on configuration entity support, and we expect to have same features in Drupal 8 version than we have in Drupal 7 by DrupalCon Barcelona in September. So a bit about Lingotek is, usually companies are not really Drupal websites, so they have several different platforms based on business requirements. What we do is that we have a translation management system that integrates with several platforms, so you can reuse your translation and your translation's memories are shared between them, so you can save time in your translation. We provide professional translation workflows, but with professional services. But we also have clients using community-based translation. Maybe their employees speak different languages, so they can provide the translations themselves. And we have also machine translation, which is quite useful when you have a low budget or no budget at all, or you want to just test your site, how it looks like in different languages, which is really useful in development. Like maybe your menu titles are shorter in Spanish than in German, so it breaks your designs, so it's easy it's a good way to just look at how it looks like, so you don't find surprises at the last moment when you get your full content translations. So I told this before, we have several workflows. And we integrate with a lot of several different systems. We have integrations with WordPress or Salesforce or different platforms, but our base implementation has been always the Drupal one. Something that is really special about the Drupal integration is that it's the only one that we built in-house. Most of the other ones are built with partners, but we had like the Drupal integration, like a sample for other systems. Yeah. So we also have a public API. So if there are other custom built platforms, you can integrate with us quite easily. Yeah. So I think I have some t-shirts here, M and L size only, sadly. If you want one, please go buy and get one. I don't want to carry them at home again. So that's it. Do you have questions, Hans?
You mentioned you have a transition management system, transition memories.
Yeah.
Do you plan to integrate it behind LDO? Because it would really have transition of the Drupal core and the modules.
No, actually.
There's an issue for that, the old, very old issue.
Yeah. It's yeah. No, that actually, our translation management tool, it's not built in Drupal. So, I mean, I don't know how we could do that.
It could be like as a service, and just the Ajax query it and get back the results and show it in the JavaScript. And then
technically, actually, they didn't use it because they fetched the original translation type from LDO. Not the Lingotek module directly, but the app and client. So when you saw the thing, the Drupal can add the LDO. And you can customize your things not based on the LDO thing, like the Lingotek transition. So you can use both.
Answer your question.
No, actually, I haven't heard about it, but I would
ask. Okay. I think it's mentioning the Lion, the L10N client module.
I have not yet. It has fetched the translation directly from LDO.
Yeah.
So, if I understood correctly, when you customize not only the untranslated things but already translated.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So you can use both the LDO translations and your translations only if I understood.
Right. Right. Actually, when we are not there yet in terms of Drupal 8, but the thing is that we will probably support like uploading only custom translations that you already marked as custom, so you can have like both systems in parallel.
I see.
Thank you. So thank you for coming.
yeah. Server connection. Yeah, you can. Do you mean if you have different sites, like with different platforms?
Yes.
Yeah, we support that.
Which platform are you using?
I use Drupal. We have integration with the WordPress for you. I think it's like a switch.
Yeah, actually, we are doing now.